they want to present this false idea that the left is always and everywhere challenging stale pieties, that they're fresh, that they're offering new ideas. With the Obama campaign, Rolling Stone dubbing him a new hope, his campaign slogan, change we can believe in. But really, when you look at what he's offering, it's the same old leftist ideas, just repackaged and tweaked, but the same thing that we've been seeing for literally hundreds of years in some cases. And with the left, they want to do that. And so it's sort of this ritual. Every generation sort of condemns the generation before and acts as if that they have, there's no continuity there, and that they gave birth to themselves. And that is problematic for the left in the sense that they never learn from their own mistakes because they're not really looking at their own history because they don't imagine that they have it. But it's also good for the left in the sense that, so if an idea fails, I mean, the ideas that they're pushing are constantly, you know, reintroduced and they constantly fail. Now, those ideas would just sort of be discarded if these were, if we were talking about people obsessed with history. But they're not obsessed with history and keep their own errors, as Santayana would say.
The Cato Institute today just released a little paper on the collectivist candidates. And we see, they mention how, you know, Obama has this big theme. He talked about he's really devoted himself to collective service, and there's a lot of high rhetoric there. But they also bring up how John McCain denounces self-indulgence and insists that Americans serve a national purpose as greater than our individual interests. So with that said, though, I mean, probably more conservatives like you and me, when it comes to our history, like, I trace my roots back to Goldwater conservatism. And I don't know, could you explain how, like, the history of American conservatism fits in today's world with a candidate like McCain? Would a candidate like McCain change where conservatism stands? Would a candidate like McCain, or just the way, the circumstances surrounding this election, you think that's going to change the history of American conservatism and where we go in a direction of our policies?
I think, unfortunately, it already has changed. And I think during the Clinton years, the impulse of some conservatives to confuse conservatism for whatever serves the Republican Party really set us in the wrong direction, in the sense that conservatism became about revealing personal scandals about Bill Clinton. And of course, liberals or Democrats don't have the market cornered on personal scandals. I mean, because someone shares your politics doesn't mean they share your ethics. And so there's all sorts of rogues and bad characters. And I certainly would include Bill Clinton in that list, but there's a lot of people on our side that would get into that as well. And so I think that was a mistake. And George W. Bush became president. A lot of conservatives forgot what conservatism was and just sort of deferred to the president and went with him on anything. And there's a few examples of rebellion. Certainly the Harriet Myers nomination and immigration would be two examples I would give where conservatives objected to the president. But I think that conservatives really acted as sheep with regard to George W. Bush. And unfortunately, a lot of those Goldwater principles that you referred to are rather weak within conservatism now. And so the way I would define conservative, strangely, would be greatly at odds with what we've seen in the last few years. I think McCain is essentially an extension of that. You know, he is from Arizona, but I don't think he shares a whole lot in common with the Barry Goldwater of 1964, and certainly George W. Bush shares next to nothing in common with him.
Well, prior to 1964, what was the role of the American right? Where did it fit? I mean, it seems so hard to tack and exact on that, I know, in an absolute, because you look at the history of how the Republican Party originally was one of nationalist tendencies, and it was the Democrats who were states' rights, and then we had the Southern Strategy under the Republicans. What would you say would be, in general, where does the American right fit in a lot of your writings, especially like regarding the Civil War and past into the New Deal?
Well, I don't write a whole lot about the American right, particularly within my books, but I think the reason you don't really see much of a conservative movement prior to the Second World War is because conservatism, in a sense, was the default position up until the Progressive Era or so. And at a certain point, conservatives started to realize their ideas were under attack. American ideal was under attack, which, you know, you brought up earlier about McCain talking about a service to country and Americans having to serve something greater. I think in a way that contradicts one of the central tenets of, you know, American idealism, which is the idea that we're individuals, that we have this federalist nation where states are separate from the national government. And then on another level, individuals are free from the tentacles of government. You see that in the Constitution, also in the Constitution of the states. So the idea that we would sort of toss that aside and become some national glob, some mass sort of pushing in a certain direction, that is alien to me as a conservative. You see a conservatism after World War II because I think conservatives realized their ideas were under attack. It was almost a reactionary movement, and that's where you get the Hayeks, the Whitaker Chambers, the Russell Kirks, the William F. Buckleys, the Henry Regnery's, all of these people coming out in reaction to what had gone on with the New Deal and the statism that was a permanent part of American government at that point.
Right. In fact, Kirk was probably the first real conservative book I read that really got me turned on to conservatism. And that's the definition of conservatism I would most likely adhere to. It's the politics of prudence. There is no set ideology. You shun the ideologue. You look for compromise. And you believe in convention, continuity, and constitution. And that's, I think that's the, when we hear these, you know, George Bush, God help him, compassionate conservatism. I mean, that was, I felt so ripped off about my own political views when he would try to sell compassionate conservatism. Because true conservatism, are you trying to say, isn't compassionate yet? And it really frustrated me today when I look at how, you know, everything's so painted with labels, and the politics of nomenclature is so pathetic when you hear conservatism. And I consider myself more of a classical liberal. So then there's like a hijacking where if you don't support the war, then you're not a conservative. If you support the war, it's conservative. And it just very much frustrates me. I know you yourself have come out very strongly against the war and have said, look, this isn't a conservative position. What do you say about that and about the war today? What would you say about the war today and John McCain and other conservatives in the party?
Well, I actually have a post right up on my site. My site is flynnfiles.com, 25 conservative critics of the war. And in doing the research for it, I was amazed at how many prominent conservatives came out against the war, or at least criticized the war in some way. You know, people like Milton Friedman, Tom Clancy, Mel Gibson, William F. Buckley, Pope Benedict, Pope John Paul II. You can go on and on. Norman Schwarzkopf. I mean, really major figures, not just on the American right, but major figures on the American scene and even on the international stage. Who are thought to be conservatives came out against the war. But if you were to, you know, watch a cable news show or listen to talk radio, you would get the idea that pro-war equals conservative and anti-war equals liberal. But of course, there are a lot of liberals like John Kerry and Hillary Clinton, Christopher Hitchens, who supported the invasion, and there are a lot of conservatives like myself who were opposed to it. And the reason that we were opposed to it, you know, it's an unwar. You know, at the time we thought that Al Qaeda, certainly I still believe that Al Qaeda is a threat and we should have taken care of that, the jihadists, and not the secular evil dictators that, you know, that Saddam Hussein was. I mean, he was a bad guy, but it's not our job to be the world's policeman or even a region's policeman. We should believe in national defense and not international defense. He may have posed a threat to his neighbors. I don't think he posed a threat to us, and so the old conservative thinking, you know, reflected in the Sharon statement, the Young Americans for Freedom's statement from the early 1960s, was that the reason for going into a war was whether it would serve America's just interests or not. So it had to serve the interests of justice, and also had to serve our national interests. I don't know that the Iraq War did either, and I think one thing that conservatives stand for. We are not revolutionaries. We're not into tearing things down. We're into building them up. And we went into a society and teared, however, you know, and believe me, they were imperfect, the existing structures we had. We tore down that evil structure, but we didn't really think about what would come after it. And this reminds me of the late 1970s when there were a lot of folks on the left, you know, begging for the Shah of Iran's head and cheering on Ayatollah Khomeini and his followers, the Nation, Mother Jones, Michel Foucault, a lot of prominent people on the left were cheering the Ayatollah Khomeini because they thought the Shah of Iran was evil. Well, he was evil, but you can get worse, and I think conservatives know that, and a lot of the people who call themselves conservatives who supported the war forget about that idea. Things can always be worse than they are. I don't know in Iraq right now if they're worse now than they were when Hussein was in power. Not good. And the idea of Iran filling that vacuum or if civil war erupting, the potential for wars is certainly there.
Which, I mean, I guess someone like McCain would just say that's the very reason why we need to stay there. So, but.
So, like, they invaded, and then, everything that we warned them against has come to pass. And I say, well, now that's what you warned us against is the reason for us staying. It just, it, it,